Morning, respected seniors. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to speak among such
Sir, speak
stalwarts of
louder.
ophthalmology. Hello, can you hear me? Hello.
Pranav, we can hear you, but it's a little soft, that's all. We can hear you, but it's soft.
Okay, ma'am. I'll try to talk a little louder.
He's a soft, very soft boy.
Yes.
You need to harden a little.
So the technological advances in ophthalmology has grown by leaps and bounds, and it is not only a duty to improve patients' vision, but it is also to refine it. And a proper management of astigmatism can lead to excellent visual outcomes, and to achieve emetropia is the target nowadays. So the goals of the surgery are mainly that there should be painless visual recovery. We should give spectacle independence to the patient. We should correct all the pre-existing astigmatism that is there. And the repeatability of the surgical results should be there. So there are maybe two types of astigmatism that we deal with, which is the with the rule and the against the rule. Against the rule is the one that is common in patients who are older, that is the cataract patients. I'll be a little brief because we have a little time left. So mainly proper preoperative assessment of pre-existing astigmatism should be done. And we can see that the prevalence is around 86.6%. The main factors are the incision characteristics, the use of cautery, and the use and non-use of suture. So we can measure the astigmatism with the help of retinoscopy, keratometry, and corneal topography. Corneal topography is the one that we prefer now, but manual keratometry can be done in patients where there is poor fixation, corneal abnormalities, distorted Myers, highly toric cornea, or dry cornea. In rest of the cases, we prefer topography. So the astigmatism correction in SICS. So the incision characteristics is very important, mainly the size of the incision, which we have already talked about. The larger the incision, the more the flattening is there and more the astigmatism, and the smaller, the lesser the flattening. So this is how we make a smaller incision and reduce the surgically induced astigmatism that is there. The distance from the cornea is very important, and the farther the incision from the cornea, the lesser the astigmatism. And the configuration should always be to hit the astigmatically neutral zone. So there may be different type of incisions which are there, the traditional smile incisions, the straight incision, the frown incision. Frown incision is the one that we prefer, but we can also go for blue menthol and chevron incision. But blue menthol and chevron are a little difficult for the novice. We make it in the astigmatically neutral zone. So this is derived from the two important equations. This was given by Koch in 91. That surgically induced astigmatism is directly proportional to the length of the incision tube. And the funnel's base is at the limbus, and as it moves away, it widens. So if we give an incision on the superior side, we tend to induce more surgically induced astigmatism, but it is easy to learn and easy to start for the starting surgeons. And a temporal incision is the one which gives lesser astigmatism. The site of incision depends on the phenomena of coupling, and the flattening effect is achieved at the tissue and steepening is produced 90 degree away. Surgically induced astigmatism is found to be around minus 1 to 1.5 diopter at 90 degree if a 6.5 millimeter incision is given. So this was a study done by Gokhale et al, and they found that superior incision is the one which is the least astigmatically induced. And incision length, as we've talked about, the larger the incision, the more the astigmatism, which can be around 1.36 if we give an incision of 7 millimeter. Also, the cautery, excessive cautery may increase in astigmatism because of scleral shrinkage and scleral necrosis. So minimal cautery should be done. So how do we correct this pre-existing astigmatism? In this case, in cases where there is mild astigmatism, we neutralize by changing the site of the incision. That is, we should always operate on the steeper axis. So this is how we reduce the pre-existing astigmatism if it is less than one diopter. Then there is limbal relaxing incisions, which we can give. It is given at a 90% depth with a guarded knife on the steeper meridian and in just in front of the limbus. So this is a video showing us giving a limbal relaxing incision. This is a frown incision that we make. We first make the tunnel, and after that, we go for the limbal relaxing. Incision, we give around a 6 millimeter, we take 6 millimeter from the calipers, and then we give, this is a guarded knife which is giving a limbal relaxing incision just in front of the limbus. So it is imperative to check the calculations to prevent any mishap, and 90 degree off is the most common error that we find. So there are multiple nomograms which are given, and these may be helpful for deciding what kind of incision to be made and how much astigmatism will be corrected with it. So there is Miller's nomogram, and then there are other nomograms which are given by James P. Gill. So the advantages are that there is less tendency of shift in the resultant cylindrical axis. There is less irregular corneal flattening and irregular astigmatism is seen. In cases of arcuate incision, we see more irregular astigmatism, and it is easier to perform than the arcuate incision. So the other thing is that we can go for an opposite clear corneal incision. This was a thing which was given by Liver and Dan, and they approached the clear corneal incision and added an identical incision on the opposite. So the amount of astigmatism corrected by it was mainly done in thickened ulceration, but we can also do it in small incision cataract surgery by giving the opposite clear corneal incision. They are just placed 1.5 to 2 millimeter inside the edge of the limbal vessels along the steeper meridian of the astigmatism. So this is a flowchart depicting how we can correct preoperative astigmatism, how we can go with the surgery. If there is low astigmatism, frown incision can be given, which is 3 millimeter behind the cornea. And in moderate cases, we can go for an incision on the steeper meridian, about 6 millimeter, and just straight in the relation to the limbus, because that will correct more astigmatism and flatten the cornea more. And in higher cases, we go for a combination of limbal relaxing incision, opposite clear corneal incision, and a incision profile. So post-operatively, we can correct the astigmatism with astigmatic keratotomy, wound revision, and excimer laser. So the take-home message is that we should do a careful identification of astigmatism magnitude and meridian, both pre-op and intra-op. And that is how we can get a good correction of the astigmatism. And we should always choose with a stepladder approach, and techniques can be effectively combined for higher levels of astigmatism. And we should always apply the incision on the steeper axis because it gets flat. Thank you.